So I'm glad to be with you here this evening at Mennonite Life. Grateful for the invitation to speak to you. I happen to be a life member of Mennonite Life. And sometime in my long ago childhood, my parents brought me here for the first time. And I got a tour from Ira Landis and met Christy Charles working away amidst a mass of dusty theological tomes somewhere down there. Along with others of you, I continue to recall with fondness and gratitude the gifts and service of Carolyn Charles Wenger. I would love to be able to discuss with her many of the things I will be talking about this evening. Standing here, I also remember particularly the life of another former staff member, David Remple Smooker. It has been my privilege to interact and collaborate with many others who have contributed to the success of this organization in the past and present. And thank you, Jean, and others now working here for your commitment to fostering knowledge, appreciation, and care for the historical and faith legacies of this region. We know of no earlier edition and no other copy of this 1564 edition of Etliche schöne christliche Gesang, some beautiful Christian songs. In 1583, most of this collection was combined as the second part of another group of hymns bearing the title Ausbund. Now, almost 460 years later, the Ausbund continues in regular use in Old Order Amish worship services, with new printings issued each year by the Amish of Lancaster County. In tonight's lecture, I'll actually be talking less about this specific treasure and more about the other kinds of treasures we find bundled with it and with some copies of other Ausbunds. But first, at least a brief overview of this remarkable and important work. As the title page informs us, this collection of songs was written by a group of fellow believers imprisoned in Passau. It was in this fortress, known as the Feste Oberhaus, or the Upper House Fortress, that some 55 prisoners were imprisoned beginning in August and September of 1535. The Oberhaus is strategically located above the confluence of three rivers, the Danube, the Inn, and the Ilz, right on the German side of the border with Austria. It is not my purpose this evening to give you a thorough account of identities and backgrounds of these prisoners, but I do want to offer a little of the context in which the writing of this collection of hymns occurred. As I trust many of you are aware, Europe of the 1500s experienced significant religious and social upheaval. In the turmoil and mix of new ideas and changes to ecclesiastical and political structures of the day, there were disparate groups, some smaller, some larger, often taking hold first in urban settings, but also traveling into rural areas. People who were seeking to practice newfound understandings of the Christian faith. Included were individuals concerned that they were convinced that they were discovering more authentic ways to live out their faith and who sought circles of like-minded believers that we classify as Anabaptists or rebaptizers. Rejection of infant baptism, often non-resistance and refusal to swear oaths, sometimes community of goods, were among characteristics found within some of these circles. Countering these were often both civil and religious power structures, sometimes working in tandem, at other times themselves in conflict, but seeking control over ideas and practices that seemed destined to upset whatever status quo the powers wanted to maintain. A sprawling Holy Roman Empire united the patchwork of most German-speaking territories into a loose confederation. By the end of the 1520s, many rulers were growing concerned because, with about cracking down on the religious heterodoxies flourishing in many places. The Edict of Speyer in April 1529 legitimized execution as a punishment for the heretics. Other rulers began, at least, with a stance of greater toleration. Off toward the eastern borders of the empire, Moravia had several local rulers who initially welcomed Anabaptists and others into their territories. This toleration drew what were essentially religious refugees from areas where rulers had instituted harsher measures. Today, we particularly think of Moravia in connection with the earliest Hutterites. But in fact, in the late 1520s and early 1530s, several larger groups of Anabaptists were flourishing in Moravia. These groups seemed to have varied in specific practices enough that they were often distinguished using an identifier based on the leader's name. One such group was called the Philippites, and it was flourishing in Hustopetze, or Auschwitz, as the Germans call it, in Moravia, under the leadership of a man named Philip Planer, hence the name Philippites. We believe this group may have had as many as 400 adults and children, 400 adults with children in 1535. Meanwhile, some 500 miles to the northwest, a little red block at the top there, the city of Münster in Westphalia had been taken over by a group of radical Anabaptists, hoping to usher in the kingdom of God on earth. This threat to the established order caused Catholic and Protestant rulers alike to unite in laying siege to the city. Some formerly tolerant local rulers, including those at Auschwitz, decided they could no longer risk the toleration they had been extending to groups such as the Philippites. Expelled from Auschwitz in the summer of 1535, the Philippites seemed to have decided to divide into smaller groups as they traveled overland to begin hunting for new homes, new places to settle. It was travelers like these whom authorities in Passau, a Catholic city, captured in several small groups in the late summer of 1535. Based on what we know of individual identities, it seems likely that these people were headed back to their original homes in southwestern Germany, sort of the blue territory. So you see the red arrow from Auschwitz to Passau. That was the distance these refugees had traveled, and they were captured in the vicinity of Passau. Likely their destination was a little further along. Passau was about 200 miles from Auschwitz, and that may have been somewhat beyond the halfway point home for many of these individuals. While in prison, at least some of this group found encouragement in writing and singing religious songs. In this collection, we find 53 different texts, some with specific indication of who wrote them, others anonymous. In modern editions of the Ausbund, 50 of these 53 texts are still included, and those are songs 81 to 130 in the second part of the Ausbund. Here you see the exterior of the binding that currently encases this rare edition. Around the year 1700, an unknown owner chose to bind the 1564 edition in the midst of several other, essentially brand new, song and prayer pamphlets. It was this fortuitous choice that allowed the book to survive to the present. This volume of bundled treasure is what bibliographers or book collectors sometimes call a Sammelband, a collective volume. And Sammelbände have separately printed items that are bound together by the choice of the owner. So you didn't go into a printer's office and find this group of things bound together. You might have bought, in this case, pamphlets from a traveling salesperson. You might have had, for whatever reason, you had this 1564 pamphlet or booklet still in your possession, and you decided you wanted these things to be in a sturdier binding, and you took it to a bookbinder and said, please bind these things. This particular Sammelbund and other examples this evening happen to include mainly songs or hymns. However, a Sammelbund could have included any combination of items based on what the owner wanted. For example, in our collection at Goshen, we also have a Sammelbund that includes a series of polemical pamphlets written back and forth between factions of 17th century Dutch Mennonites disputing each other's doctrines during the so-called War of the Lambs. And so you have a pamphlet that makes a statement about doctrine. You have someone criticizing that person's explication of doctrine. You have a response to the criticism, and it went back and forth. And in a few years in the 1660s, there were probably several dozen such pamphlets printed in among the Dutch Mennonites. And at least one owner, whose copy we eventually got, bound about 8 or 9 of these together. Makes it very handy to read through them in order. Political pamphlets, satirical verses, pamphlets of a particular era or a particular author, all of these things might have been bound together into Sammelbunde by a particular owner. We are grateful to the unknown owner who chose to include this particular work, this 1564 edition of the Passau Songs, into his or her volume at a time when other more comprehensive editions of the Ausbund were available. So I imagine someone who had this many printed items could easily have gotten a newly printed Ausbund that already included those Passau songs at the back, most of them at least, and could have thought, well, why not just bind this, and this old thing doesn't need to be kept. But thank goodness that they did keep this. Without it, we would imagine that such a booklet existed, but we would not know when it was printed or where or how. In 1928, Harold S. Bender, a well-known Anabaptist historian and Goshen College professor, early promoter of our Mennonite Historical Library at Goshen, was browsing books at James Lewis Hook's antiquarian bookstore on South Market Square in Harrisburg. There, he ran across this very volume. And he leafed through it and discovered near the back this unusual item with a very different date than the other items in the volume. And although it does not have the word Ausbund in the title, he recognized the title of Etliche Christliche Schöne Gesänge as words that appear after Ausbund in the title of Ausbunds. The story is that he might not have disguised his excitement, and also that he didn't have enough money to pay the price for the whole volume. And so the bookseller said, well, this is what you really want. And so the volume was divided at that point, and Harold Bender spent the $10 he had to buy the back part of the volume. Now, this is sort of what the volume looked like before restoration in 2015. And maybe it deteriorated a little bit in the 80, 90 years after being purchased in 1928. But I suspect that actually that's pretty close to what it might have looked like when Harold purchased first the back part, and fortunately within another year or so he had the front part too. Somewhere in the middle of the volume there were additional items. In fact, right before the Passau songs, something else was in that volume, we know from the width of the spine, that is no longer present. And because of the way samobans function, we can have no idea what was lost and when it was lost. Mm. Some people like to imagine the bookseller tore the volume in half. I hope that actually the volume was already loose and he didn't really rip it actively apart, but more divided it. And I'm glad that Harold did buy the rest of it too. For almost 100 years now, that volume has been in the care of the historical library. And in 2015, we decided that this treasure deserved to be strengthened and prepared for several more centuries of survival. With some trepidation, I packed up the book and shipped it to Jeff Peachy in New York City, a very talented conservator who happens to have grown up a few blocks from our library. Jeff disassembled the entire volume, carefully cleaned, repaired, and strengthened each individual leaf, and then reassembled the volume so we can handle and consult it with far less risk to its pages. And if you want to read more about this, the October 2016 issue of Pennsylvania Mennonite Heritage has a very informative article that Jeff Peachy wrote with Irvin Beck about the 1564 Passau songs in general and the conservation process. Here again, you see the cover after restoration. And as you notice, it was our choice not to disguise the many faults that occurred to the binding in more than three centuries. So there are still pieces of leather missing from the boards. There are the secondary repairs that were made with leather strips along the top and bottom of the spine that would not have been original, but somewhere along the line, someone was already trying to keep the book together a little better. So we kept all of that as evidence of the volume's history. He did restore it to full working order, however. But now I want to take you on a little tour of what's inside this bundle. And in the process, talk a little bit about the ways that the evidence we have for the hymns and songs that were of interest to and used by Amish and Mennonites in addition to the Ausbund, so used alongside probably, not necessarily integrated as occasionally throughout the Ausbund's history, more songs got integrated, but or added to the end. But I think for most of the history of the use of the Ausbund in Europe, there were always additional songs, additional hymns that for shorter or longer periods of time were part of regular use among the Anabaptists. This is the first item that is in the volume. And you may notice that it has a 1696 publication date. In fact, it says, printed in the year of Christ, 1696. Very often the pamphlets, song pamphlets, perhaps to preserve their currency, just say printed in this year, or printed in the year that true repentance was needed. So those are both good statements that allow you to keep marketing the same pamphlet that you say are beautiful. Often you'll say they're new songs. This happens to say they're two beautiful spiritual songs. And this, although a specific example, is also kind of a generic example of a song pamphlet, such as enjoyed wide distribution from the 16th century and even into the early 19th century. Very often we think these were sold by traveling merchants. Sometimes they might have come around and you could have bought ribbons or a song pamphlet. Little things that were sold farmstead to farmstead, or perhaps in city markets. They were economical and could be impulse purchases. Thanks to a German scholar, Eberhard Nelson, who has collected information and studied thousands of these pamphlets. I've studied hundreds, he's studied thousands. And he's also paid a lot of attention to printer's ornaments and typefaces and stuff. And he has identified this, although it doesn't name the printer, he has identified this as being printed in Bern, Switzerland by Jakob Antony Vulpius, who was an active printer of the era. And in our lists of various pamphlets, we know that the first song, which is actually a new song, the second song is an older song, but the first song was printed at least as early as 1688, and it was also printed again in 1704. I suspect because it doesn't crop up in a lot of other publications, that it was not overly popular. And maybe that was sort of the extent of its life, that someone came up with it around 1680s and it survived for 20 years or a generation. We think of current worship or praise songs that have a period of popularity. They get used for a while and then something else comes along. It is technically an original text, but it relies on the repetition of fairly common phrases. And it has only five verses. Many of these songs have many more. But to save even more effort in the composition, the five verses alternate phrases at the end of each verse. So one verse ends with, "Ach, Jesus, do not forget me. Jesus, meine Zuversicht, Jesus, my sure defense." And then the next verse is, instead of "Ach, Jesus," it's "My Jesus, do not forget me. Jesus, my sure defense." And that repeats, so that's about a third of the content are those repeated things. And though we can well imagine that a Swiss Anabaptist of the era may have taken comfort in the text, which speaks of such things as God's faithfulness, even if driven from your home, something that was happening to a fair number of people in Canton Bern at that time. The language is too general to attribute it exclusively to Anabaptist authorship. Paired with it, though, in case you weren't quite sure about the new song, you got a pretty standard song, "Frisch auf meine Seele, verzage nicht," "Cheer up my soul, fear not," which is a well-known and oft-published hymn, a Lutheran hymn of the 16th century by a Kasper Schmucker, but Lutheran, and it's included in both Lancaster's Unparteiisches Gesangbuch and Franconia's Kleine Geistige Harfe, so it has a long life in German in hymnody. And unlike the first song, which I have not located in any hymnal collection, "Frisch auf mein Seele" is in numerous hymnals. If, however, you were someone who didn't own a major hymnal by a Swiss Reformed or Lutheran congregation, you might not have had access to that hymn except in this pamphlet form. The next item, sadly, I don't have the title page because the title page is missing and several other pages. And throughout the volume, there are a number of leaves missing that came out over the course of time. But this is actually a 96-page pamphlet that's called the newly gathered spiritual song booklet. And it also is dated 1696. So again, we're getting that feeling, that sense of when these things might have been brought together in a single volume. It, however, is something that we can more readily identify as having been prepared for use by Anabaptists, probably. And I'll go into the content a little more. But again, there are, especially at the end, some familiar hymns that have much wider circulation. The first hymn, "Ein Liedlein will ich singen schön," I want to sing this small song beautifully, is about the Sermon on the Mount. Now, it's pretty descriptive. It doesn't get into the doctrine so much as just saying, you know, Jesus was up on the mountain and preached, and these are things that happened. the fourth song, I won't bother going through all 24 songs for you, but the fourth song is the first one that really brings this pretty tightly into our circles of Anabaptists, even though it also is not of likely not written by Anabaptists. But Es ist ein wunderschöner Gab, and perhaps Joe Lapp and others would recognize that immediately as the third of five songs added to the 1751 Ausbund in the Germantown appendix. So that makes it into the Ausbund in North America. Here it's floating around in the same circles in its own booklet with several other songs. It's sometimes been mistakenly attributed to Hans Reist in some otherwise reliable secondary source, because one of its manifestations is in a pamphlet with a prayer that also, in my opinion, is mistakenly attributed to Hans Reist. And I'll talk a little more about the prayer at later on. But this, again, is an example of a hymn text that was popular over time and not just among the Anabaptists, but was never made it into hymnals. It first was printed at least as early as the 1580s, so long before Hans Reist was alive or could have written it. There are two songs in here, 13 and 14, that are very somber songs about death. The bitter death was around for at least 20 years before that. And this one, along with Wunderschöne Gab, are hymns that made it into a later Swiss prayer and song booklet called the Kleines Handbüchlein that was later 18th century, 1786, I think, is the first edition. And although that collection didn't make a big inroad into North America, there are copies that come over with later immigrants, but it had had many editions in Switzerland in the 19th century particularly. And then there's also Der Grimmig Tod, Grim Death with His Arrow, which, although it didn't make it into the Unparteiisches Gesangbuch, did make it into Kleine Geistliche Harfe, and is also in collections like the Marburger Gesangbuch that was popular in colonial Pennsylvania. And that also had been circulating in pamphlet form since at least the beginning of the 1600s. And then at the end, there are several things such as Aus meines Herzens Grunde und Werde munter meine Seele, which are very familiar hymns, and again are part of the modernized content of Unparteiisches Gesangbuch and Kleine Geistliche Harfe here in Pennsylvania. Here's another item that we have just the third of the three songs, but because of the caption title, we know it's called the third, so, and we have the end of the pamphlet, so we know there were three songs. And with a little digging around to find out how many pamphlets had this as its last song, I was able to find that, in fact, two of the three songs were written by a 24-year-old young man, Rudolf Grünig, who may have come from close to Lake Thun in Canton Bern. We don't have any suggestion that Grünig family had Anabaptist connections, but he would have been living right in the middle of many Anabaptists. And his songs are also rather dark, rather pessimistic songs about the weight of his sinful nature, concluding that he must simply continue to bear his cross and suffering willingly until God releases him and crowns him with honor and splendor. So again, that is a particularly personal kind of song. It's not communal as many of the Passau songs are, but it's something that might have appealed to someone facing a bit of difficulty. On this leaf, you can also see the treacherous remains of old Scotch tape that were used to keep that page in there. And that was part of Jeff's work, was to remove as much as he could of whatever had filtered into the paper. Couldn't remove the marks, but one of our choices was we didn't want to try to bleach things to make it clean. We left visible what was visible. And you can also see on the edge of this, Japanese paper repairs that, so he completed the leaf where it was imperfect. Yet another three lovely new spiritual songs printed in 1699. And that's the newest date we have. And that's where I came up with the around 1700, because a fair number of things that we have are printed, are dated. We are somewhat confident that this is about the time it would have been bound. And although this edition, this particular copy was printed in Bern, the same three songs were printed by the von Meckel family, who very likely was printing Ausbunds in the 18th century, at least twice more. So this particular combination. Now, truth in advertising was not always the case, even in the late 1600s. And so although this says it's three beautiful new songs, in fact, the songs are hardly new. And the ballad, the first is a ballad about the two disciples on the road to Emmaus, and it had already been circulating for at least a century and would continue to circulate for about 50, at least another 50 years. And another sign that not everything is new, the woodcut from that title page, actually, it comes directly from a woodcut that was used at least 160 years earlier. So that, and it was cut down already. So this is, the larger one is, appears in a publication from a predecessor in the same public printing family in Bern in 1540 and 1699 in a decrepit and abridged state, it's still being used. One of the things that's tempting is to look at the little ornaments that are on the title pages of Ausbunds and assume that that proves that they're printed by the same person or the same printer. It's useful information, but the ornaments on the Ausbund title pages look like they were made of metal, and those could be reproduced more easily. A woodcut, on the other hand, is less likely to be reproduced exactly, and so to have the same woodcut descend through the same family of printers is a little surer evidence of connection than necessarily the metal printer's ornaments. So after that pamphlet comes the part that we don't know what was in the Ausbund. And as much as I would love to find that out, there's no way to do that. Might it have been something as exciting as the 1564 Passau songs? I don't know. I'm guessing not, but it still would have been nice to know what else that same owner chose to include. Fortunately, like Harold Bender, we move on and we find that the Passau songs are in there. It's hard to see on this image, but if you come up and look, I think you will notice that one of the things that owner did, or the binder did, was the 1564 publication was not as tall as the other pamphlets. And so there is a extra strip of blank paper pasted onto every leaf of that booklet, 120 or whatever leaves there are in it, and to make it fit. So it's a nice bound where the pages don't flop around over the empty space. And then there's a final item. And here again, you see very clearly the kind of repair that Jeff Peachey did for a page that was in horrible shape. And it, rather than songs or a song, is a called A Lovely Spiritual Prayer. It's we have a few leaves of it, but we're not quite sure if we're missing a title page before this, or two at the end, or three at the end. We just can't quite figure it out, and I haven't found another copy of this particular printing of the prayer. The printed prayer, though, is one of at least four versions of a prayer that seems likely to have been transmitted and revised over the course of several printings. And although at least two versions of the prayer are printed with attributions, that one to Hans Reiss that I mentioned earlier, and the other one to a name Hans Rusch, otherwise unknown, the content does vary, but it seems to be cut and paste group of similar content. So it seems to me safest to not identify this as being any specific author, whether Hans Reiss or anyone else. Some parts are abridged or expanded from printing to printing. In this particular printing, the criticism of civil magistrates is presented in a noticeably sharper tone than the similar passage in the pamphlet that identifies Hans Reiss as the author. And there's a segment on the good-hearted and a segment on the magistracy in both, but they're switched around in order. So it seems to be that these were prayer ideas, and somebody wanted to print them out, but they were kind of playing with the same content, and it wasn't necessarily really the prayer of any specific individual. So, as mentioned at the beginning, it was not just songs that might be combined. From the end of the 1600s, we know of a fair number of Sammelbände, or at least Sammelband-like collections of doctrinal writings, usually centered around one of several German language printings of the Dordrecht Confession of Faith, T.T. von Siddert's Appendix, Leonard Gluck's Prayers, and optional inclusions of the Schleitheim Confession or other pieces. It's possible for those that the printer may indeed have sold sort of mix and match sets, as this seems also to be have happened with some of the 18th century editions of Goldene Äpfel, the golden apples in silver bowls. The specific content, which occasionally varies from copy to copy. But as I conclude this lecture, I want to mention just three additional examples of song pamphlets that exemplify the roles played by such prints in the evolution of Anabaptist hymnody. Though not preserved in this particular Sammelband, all are examples of texts we know thanks to other Sammelbände. Harold Bender's discovery of the 1564 Passau songs is arguably the most significant of his many acquisitions for the Mennonite Historical Library. I think the most significant acquisition of a printed item during the past 35 years when I've been working there has been this pamphlet copy of the song Mit Lust so will ich singen, I sing with exultation. Many of us using either Ausbund or various recent Mennonite English language hymnals know this text, at least in part. And the discovery of this was not quite as exciting as Harold Bender's. It came in an email from a Swiss bookseller. I was very excited by seeing the email, but it's a little different to be strolling through a store and picking up and leafing through something and finding something. Still, I read my email that day, so that was good. We don't have the Sammelband that preserved it originally, but we know that it was part of a Sammelband owned by a high school music teacher in Germany in 1911, though most of the items in the Sammelband were not songs particularly. And this is the only item I can honestly say in that volume that I would have had direct interest in. So although in general I would be against taking books apart, I happen to be very happy this book was taken apart. Sometime in the 1960s, the pieces began to be sold individually. And so the very piece of interest to us, we were able to purchase. And the cost was more than $10. One thing that's, so the printer of this pamphlet is actually identified just by his initials, but we know it's Jakob Fröhlich in Strasbourg and was printed likely in the 1540s. So that's, and this text is not in the Passau songs, it is in the other songs added in 1583. In 1583, the Ausbund says this text is written by Felix Mons. This particular text, which has a few other variations in text, not many, doesn't have any attribution. That doesn't mean the 1583 Ausbund is wrong, but it also at least opens the possibility that that attribution was offered somewhat symbolically, as happens, we believe, with the attribution to the song by Michael Sattler. Another thing I like about this is that in Strasbourg, which was sort of a middle ground between Reformed and Lutheran Protestant reformations, and where there were some individuals very open to tolerating even Anabaptist individuals, including one woman, Katharina Schützel, and she had a role in partnership with this very printer of printing some of the very first German language Protestant hymns translated from hymns written by the Bohemian Brethren a century earlier. She made those available to Strasbourg in smaller booklets. Instead of printing a big book of hymns, she wanted people to be able to afford them, and so she printed four different small booklets, including some hymns that make it into the 1583 Ausbund. Not this particular one, but this came later. Anyway, I like that as another connection to the printing history of songs. There are other hymns in the Ausbund that have song pamphlets that precede the printing of the Ausbund. And it could be that very many of the hymns did, but we just have a few examples. And I'm showing here two of the same song, O Gott Vater ins Himmels Throne, which is number 55, Godfather on the Throne of Heaven. And this is a communion hymn, and we believe written by an Anabaptist, Hans Schmidt, but it was popular beyond Anabaptist circles, and particularly in pamphlets, but also in hymnals. So not only did Anabaptist hymnals borrow from other Protestant hymnals, but Protestant hymnals borrowed Anabaptist texts. And this song also made it into the Unparteiisches Gesangbuch here in Lancaster in 1804 as number 102. There's another example of another printing, this time with three other songs, the first time it was alone. Now here, one of the best known ballad songs of the Anabaptists, the Haslibacher Lied, that tells the martyrdom of Hans Haslibacher of Sumiswald in Bern in 1571, likely the last execution in the city of Bern. And in 32 verses tells the story, talks about the three prophecies that Haslibacher gave before he was executed, that his head, when struck off, would spring into a hat and laugh aloud, the sun would turn blood red, and the town fountain would spew blood. And according to the song, all three prophecies came to pass. And the hangman too then was heard to say, "'Tis guiltless blood I've shed today." So this song, which again in North America finally makes it directly into the Ausbund as the 140th song, was printed in Basel at least as early as 1630. And that is that's not this copy, but appropriately enough, that earliest known printing of that we find bound together with a 1622 Ausbund in the Waterloo Public Library. So even though it's not until Germantown that the Hasli-Bacher Lied gets printed right with the Ausbund, already in 1622, there was an association there, and you find it in many other things. There are numerous printings of this hymn, sometimes alone, at least six printings alone, two with two other songs, two with three other songs, three with four other songs, and you get them into even bigger collections of 9, 10, and even more songs. Like another song I mentioned earlier, this the Wunderschöne Gab, this was anthologized in Europe, not in the Ausbund, but in the Kleines Handbuchlein, and was actually, the content of it wasn't part of Thielmann von Brock's Dutch Martyr's Mirror, but in Ephrata, they added the story of Hans Hasli-Bacher into that. And the final song will be, sorry, I forgot I was adding this. So some pamphlets then begin to be almost regular appendices to the Ausbund, and you find multiple ones. And so you have this five beautiful new songs. And the second one there happens to be the Hasli-Bacher song. And you find multiple copies of Ausbunds that have this same pamphlet bound with it. So it's almost as if they're issued together. Then you begin to have larger collections that have new songs. And I picked this Shabab Lied, the Shabab song, because it's written by Lancaster County immigrant Benedict Breckbill, 1709. He reports that he wrote it on a Sunday afternoon while in prison in Bern and finished it by 5 in the afternoon. So it was an inspired song. Shabab is an interesting, it's sort of something that you cast off, and it's particularly used to talk about flowers that are sort of roadside weeds, but they don't have much value. And apparently at some points in time in Switzerland, it would be, if you were telling someone were no longer interested in dating them, you might give them some of these flowers, and you were given Shabab. So Breckbill works with that image and considers himself cast off, but recognizes that God will not cast him off. So that's, this together with several other songs here, the Durst Rutis song, O Herum Deine Gnade Ruf Ich, makes it into the Ausbund, and I think there's one other in this particular collection. It's printed twice, but although God does not cast Benedict off, we did cast off his song. So that didn't continue. It got printed several times. I've never found it alone. It's always been in either 9 or 10 books. And that's what happens to some of these songs. So that brings me to the end of my presentation. I thank you for your attention and would be happy to take questions if you have any. Yes.
Is that last one in any Ausbund edition?
The Shabab? Yeah. No. It may be bound, that booklet that has it in may be bound with an Ausbund offhand. I don't know that for sure. But it's not, it was never incorporated into the content of the Ausbund. And of course, when the Ausbund came to North America, it was being used by both Mennonite and Amish. And it's not as though as Mennonites sort of stopped using it and Amish continued using it, the canon of the Ausbund had already been completed. So it wouldn't have been impossible for it to get added, but it never did, seemingly. So. Yes?
I think you implied that the song that's credited to Michael Sattler in the Ausbund might not have been written by him. Could you expand on that a bit?
So, yeah, that song is actually one of the text of that song is already included in those four little pamphlets that were printed in Strasbourg in the 1530s and were almost entirely translations of songs by Bohemian brethren that had been written 100 years earlier. Now, I got that from a secondary note. I haven't gone through it myself, but it does seem possible, plausible that it did not originate with Michael Sattler. We have many other of Michael Sattler's writings, so there's a with the Schleitheim Confession and something that looks like a Salmobahn but isn't. There's a small biblical concordance and then Schleitheim Confession and a bunch of Michael Sattler's writings. But I'm personally a little suspicious. I need to do more direct investigation, but the source that was describing this, I think, was in fact, I think it was in the Mennonite Encyclopedia that they mentioned this. So I think that someone did more work than I have at this point on that. Yes?
You mentioned that the Ausbund borrowed, as you called it, from other hymn collections. Since I'm connected with the Lutheran Church, I'd like to know, did any Lutheran created hymns, composed by Martin Luther, for example, end up in the Ausbund?
Yeah, I don't think that any of Martin Luther's hymns are in the 1583 Ausbund. I don't know. Someone else may know better than I, but I don't think any of his are. But there are definitely hymns that are Lutheran in origin, scattered in there. Just as there are some Anabaptist hymns scattered in Lutheran hymnals of the same era. So, yes?
How many of the songs in that book would be represented in the newest Mennonite hymnal?
In the Passau songs?
Yes.
I don't know. My wife may be more up to date on that than I. So the latest Voices Together actually, I think, has increased the number of texts from the 16th century that are included. The 1969 Mennonite hymnal had a handful. I think the 1990s worship book decreased a little bit, and I think it's gone up again. But I haven't studied that carefully to see how many are actually in, but I think they have several new texts that weren't in. The I Sing with Exaltation, the one that I had that's attributed to Felix Mons, has been in all three of the most recent Mennonite denominational hymnals and was we were able to purchase that pamphlet by someone who gave a donation in honor of Marion Wenger, who was the person who translated that hymn for the 1969 hymnal. So it was a nice honor for that original pamphlet to be purchased in his honor.
Two parts.
Yeah.
Anecdotally, Amish friends over my life have indicated that much of the Ausbund songs are still being sung in Amish meetings. Is that a fair assumption?
Yeah, so not 100%, and different communities will sing different hymns more frequently, but I don't know if anyone here can give a percentage of the ones that are in active use. Others might be read, and others might not be read at all, but there are definitely hymns that, if you're in one area of the country, you would find sung, and in another area of the country, they would be relatively unfamiliar, but then a pretty broad expanse of hymns that are used regularly throughout. And there's one song, of course, in the Ausbund that is sung at every Amish worship service, the Loblied, which didn't make it into the Ausbund until 1622, but that one is the most frequently sung and the most commonly sung of any.
being that the reluctancy to have photos taken, I would think there'd be a reluctancy to have things recorded too. And I was wondering, has anybody ever tackled the project of trying to get some of these?
There have been various recordings made in various settings and by various means. Some of the most detailed recordings that are available, as far as I know, have been recorded by people who had grown up in Amish settings and knew the songs well, but were not themselves. I think there is often a hesitancy, I don't know that it's universal, to knowingly sit down and have them recorded. There's actually a major project now nearing completion in Innsbruck in Austria, where there is a careful study of, I think, all of the Ausbund and other songs sung in any religious setting by Iowa Amish. And I don't know enough details about how they gathered those recordings, but I also know that sensitivities can be different in different communities. I know there's a careful, and there have been numerous dissertations. There's a wonderful dissertation done in the last decade by Yuan Fulkel about Lancaster County Amish singing. And although she doesn't have recordings in it, she has a great deal of information about the use of notebücher, so a notated guides to singing Ausbund melodies that are used to strengthen the singing of the community. So people particularly interested in them use these little guides and practice the songs in ways that strengthen a uniformity of the melody, as I understand it, and it's a fascinating dissertation to read. It's actually available online from the University of Maryland, but I haven't quite finished reading it, but every time I go to it, I learn something new and am amazed at the sensitivity with which she notices differences in what people are doing with the music. So, yeah.
If there are some Lutheran songs in the Ausbund, is it known if there are any Swiss Reform songs?
I think they come from across, and there are probably even a few Catholic. I can't immediately name such for you. I know in these collected volumes, every once in a while, specifically Catholic song pamphlet comes up that's so clearly Catholic, it can't have been a mistake, and yet it's in the midst of an Anabaptist owner's thing. I haven't done enough careful study of the origins of all of the first 80 songs of the 1583 Ausbund. I'm more familiar with the Passau songs, which are more clearly written by a group of prisoners. One interesting theory about the Passau songs, which I certainly am open to considering, is that because these people were part of a community that we can document as having been a singing community before they were captured. So there are various references to the Philippites that indicate that they sang. And so it's possible that maybe some of those 53 songs actually came with them into prison already and were sung. I mean, that not all were composed there. There's some that are very clearly composed there, but it could be that they also included in that 53 songs that had begun before they ever got to prison. But there's no way to test that hypothesis. Yes.
There's an Amish scholar from Ohio named Klein, I forget his first name.
Joe?
Yes. About 2 years ago, I had the privilege of transcribing a lecture that he gave on songs in the Ausbund. And one of the things I remember that he mentioned was that the tunes are basically set by the meter of the poem. And so the song leaders can pick different tunes, and that over time they kind of standardize the tune to the meter of the song. But he mentioned that some of the tunes actually were common popular tunes and melodies that the Anabaptists would sing. So if the town leaders would hear them singing, they wouldn't be so suspicious of them singing godly spiritual songs, but they might think that they're actually singing songs, yeah, you know, that were popular for the day. And so I thought that was kind of interesting, yeah, how some of the tunes that were, yeah, adopted, so they were actually from a common...
Yeah, the melodies very clearly are drawn from a wide variety of sources. I would say, although it's possible that the authorities might have mistaken it for a popular hymn or popular song, that wouldn't necessarily have been the reason they sung it to it. So it was very common practice to be borrowing melodies, yeah, and of course, it wouldn't have hurt to have it disguised like that, but I'm not sure that was the motivation. I think it was as much, you know, this is a nice tune, and I want to put spiritual words to it. Yeah. And that was not just the Anabaptists who were doing that. That was everybody, including Martin Luther. So. Yeah.
When did the Mennonites transition from using the Ausspoon to more modern hymns first? And was it an ongoing thing, or
so the in North America, it's pretty clear that that major transition away from Ausbund as the primary hymnal occurred at the beginning of the 19th century, and in practically the same year, so 1803 over east in Franconia area, and 1804 here in Lancaster, two new collections of hymns were printed for the first time. Now, they included hymns from the Ausbund. They also were not, they probably didn't include very many of the song pamphlet literature. They actually drew more from other hymnals, from other groups that were present. And Philip Stolzfus did a very careful study of all the hymns in the Unparteiisches Gesangbuch, and you can, I mean, I always keep a copy of that handy because I want to, I mean, that's what I did with some of these. I just looked up, well, did that make it in? And I could see, yes, it made it in, and I could tell right away, was it Reformed? Was it Lutheran? Was it Pietist? Was it Radical Pietist? So he has them all categorized to the extent but most of the hymns in the Unparteiisches Gesangbuch are not new hymns by any means. They are, and later on, Mennonites begin writing hymns for their own collections a little more than they did in those first two. I'm not sure how many new Mennonite hymns are in either of those, but there might be some. Steve.
The missing item in this Psalmbund, based on the width of the binding, do you have an estimate of the size of that piece, just how many leaves?
Well, it's not small, so it's not. And of course, it could have been one big thing or a bunch of little things, but it could have been. I mean, it's. I don't know. I would say it could easily be 80 pages of material. And a lot of these pamphlets are 8 or 16 pages. Yeah, Julia.
At what point did the Ausbund get canonized, as you said, and had like a canonical list of songs?
Well, I think almost from 1583, because it appeared again. So that suggested that it was going to be important. And when it appeared again, there were a few changes, but not many. And then from time to time, it continues to have a few changes, but not many. So it seemed to be the collection that those who were using it wanted to use in basically that form. And yet, that incredibly important song for continued use, the Loblied, that song 131 that is used in every worship service, waited until 1622 to be there. So it's not that it was a closed canon completely, but it was, it stayed pretty stable and doesn't grow too much. And then, like I said, the final words are the final editions occur in North America, still in the 18th century.
There's one from online that says, is there any evidence that church leaders took an active hand in selecting or rejecting songs, or is the evolving repertoire driven by printers and the market? And that's from Evan Kreider in Vancouver, Canada.
Okay. Well, the for the 1583 Ausbund, we get a pretty clear sense that it was committee work. And we don't have clear evidence for how things were debated or moderated for further editions, but I would say, I would tend to imagine that it was the choice of church leaders rather than the choice of printers. Printers had all these options to print all these songs that they wanted, but to print a sizable hymnal would have required a desire of a group to say, we want this hymnal. And for that reason, I think they also probably said, and we want this with it. I don't know of any source documents related to Sauer's negotiations with printing of the Germantown Ausbunds, but there too, I would find it hard to believe that the printer alone would have said, oh, I'm just gonna add these six songs. I think it would have been the group saying, our group wants to this and we wanna buy it. I think there are some statistics that kind of show maybe how long it took to sell the edition, the copies of the 1742 Ausbund, and then the 1751 seemed to have sold more quickly. And there are some theories about why that happened. But I think that, I don't think it would have been the printer choosing to add things. I think it would have been a group decision. It might have not been the whole group, but some important part of the group that was arranging for the publishing. Don?
Was music at the time, you know, 300-500 years ago, was it all slow tunes like chants? Did they have half slow tunes or fast tunes?
So you should have been at Elizabethtown for Hedda Dornbaugh's wonderful description of the evolution of slow tunes. We don't really know, but one of the things that, and I can't say this nearly as well as Hedda Dornbaugh, who's a hymn specialist of many years, but part of how the slow tunes probably evolve is that in a tradition of oral singing that is non-directed, so you don't have directed singing, but a group is singing together, and you have the person who begins the song, and then the other people come in, and so that already is sort of a breaking of what happens in the song, and then you have embellishments happening in the course of that. So it's unlikely that the people singing from the 1583 Ausbund would, if you heard someone singing the same song today in Lancaster County, it's very unlikely that that would have sounded that way in 1583. But maybe by 1703, it was beginning to sound like what we hear today. So that's it's a process over continuous use in over time with a certain style of group singing that is not not following notation but following an oral guidance.
Let's just take one more.
Okay.
Is there any indication ever of tuning to go along with the written words?
There's almost always, and in the Auspund, I think always, there is an indication of the tune. Mm-hmm. There are resources where we can find the tunes with notation from the 16th century for many of them, not quite all of them. But because of that evolution in singing style, it's not, you can't necessarily map what the current version is onto those notes. It doesn't work that way. That's not how the melody evolved. But the melody is identified in the Auspund particularly, and say this is the melody that you sing. But there's no notes in the Auspund, and that was very common in all hymnals. But very often we do have examples of 16th century hymnals that did include notation that have the melody named, so we know, yes, that could have been the very melody they were thinking of in 1583. Well, thank you so much.
Thank you, Joe. Thanks for sharing your expertise with us. It's been a wonderful evening. Safely return home, and let's give him another hand.